I'll be discussing some of the properties and functions of this layer, talk about framing, framing overheads, and collisions, talk about the LLC and MAC sublayers, which are conceptual divisions of this layer into two parts. So the data link layer is the second layer in the OSI model. It's the second layer up from the bottom. It sits on top of the physical layer, and the network layer sits on top of it. And the data link layer is the first layer of the OSI model that's primarily implemented in software. As we said before, the physical layer is typically implemented using hardware devices. But the data link layer is primarily implemented in software. Now, this software could be software running in a standard computer system, but more frequently, it's actually software that's embedded in the physical devices themselves, such as the switches, network adapters, other types of network devices. We call this type of embedded software firmware, because it's actually built, sort of built into the hardware, so to speak. It's not really a general purpose piece of software that we would install separately. Now, the data link layer has two important functions. It's responsible for transferring data between two devices on the same network segment. So that means if you have two devices that are very near each other, or even two wide area network devices that are directly connected on the same network segment, the data link layer will get data between those two devices. Now, it does this by splitting the data into units known as frames. And frames are simply groups of bits that comprise one unit of data along with some header information and some error checking. If we look at IEEE 802.3 Ethernet, for example, we can see that a frame consists of a header of 22 to 26 octets or bytes in length, a payload of 42 to 1500 bytes, and a 32-bit cyclic redundancy check, or a checksum, that can be used to detect errors in the rest of the frame. Now, if we break the header down into its component parts, there's a 7-byte preamble, a 1-byte start of frame delimiter, a 6-byte destination MAC address, a 6-byte source MAC address, an optional VLAN tag, which if present is 4 bytes long, and a size field of 2 bytes that tells us the size of the frame. Now, notice that I have this header here. This is a minimum of 22 bytes, and this CRC here, which is a 4-byte or 32-bit checksum. Frame headers and checksums add overhead to the payload to be transmitted. So if I want to send 1500 bytes of data, and I'm going to send it over an Ethernet connection, at layer 2, at the data link layer, I'm going to be adding a bare minimum of 26, possibly up to 30 bytes of overhead to that payload. That means that in order to transmit 1500 bytes, I'm going to have to transmit 1526 to 1530 bytes over the physical layer, because I have to transmit this header and this checksum along with the payload. The payload is simply what we're interested in sending over the network. So that could be the contents of a file, that could be a web page, that could be anything that we want to get from one end of the network to the other. So in order to send any 1500 byte block, I have to have this header and checksum. So that works out to just under a 2% overhead, 26 bytes out of every 1500. And that's without VLAN tagging. It gets a little bit higher if we use VLAN tags. So, for every 1500 bytes that I transmit, I have to send at least 1526 at the data link layer through the underlying physical layer. So if we take 1500, we divide it by 1526, we get that payloads comprise about 98.3% of the data sent over the physical layer. So however much data that I have passing through the data link layer and going to the physical layer, with Ethernet at least, about 98.3% of that is going to be data I'm interested in. The rest is going to be overheads. But recall that we talked in the physical layer about the fact that when we talk about the speed of a link, we are often talking about the physical layer speed. Gigabit Ethernet, for example, gives us 1 gigabit per second, or 125 decimal megabytes per second, at the physical layer. But only 98.3% of that is actually used for the payload, in other words, the data that we're actually interested in sending through the data link layer. So if we were to measure the speed of this link at the data link layer, we would measure it at only about 983 megabits per second, or about 123 megabytes per second. So we're losing a full 2 decimal megabytes, a full 2 million bytes per second over the link, simply because we've added in this data link layer that's adding overhead. And what will happen is, if we add a network layer on top of that, which we almost always do, we'll see our effective speed go down even further, because the network layer is going to add additional overhead. And this is just a property of the system. It's a normal and expected property of the system. So what do we get for all this overhead? Well, whenever we have multiple network devices on the same shared medium. Now, this was the case with original Ethernet when it was a shared bus. These days with switched Ethernet, this isn't so much a problem, but it is still a problem with wireless devices because they're sharing the same airspace, sharing the same set of radio frequencies. Two network devices might try to transmit a frame at the same time. If that should happen, the two frames interfere with each other, and the result is a garbled message that neither recipient can decode properly. It's meaningless data for both recipients that were trying to receive the two frames that collided. So the data link layer has to handle collision situations. One of the first things it needs to be able to do is ensure that the channel is clear before trying to transmit. Make sure that another device isn't transmitting before it tries to transmit. This is called Carrier Sense Multiple Access, or CSMA. The data link layer also needs to be able to detect when a collision occurs or have a way of avoiding collisions, either collision detection, CD, or collision avoidance, CA. Collision avoidance is the current standard for most wireless communications devices. Now, we can break the data link layer conceptually into two sublayers: the logical link control, or LLC, sublayer, and the media access control, or MAC, sublayer. The LLC sublayer allows multiple different network layers to share the same data link layer at the same time. It performs something called multiplexing. So it allows different network layer technologies to be used at the same time over the same link. The logical link control layer can also provide some flow control, error correction, message acknowledgement type features, although those are optional. The media access control layer provides layer 2 addressing of devices. So we've said that two devices that are on the same network segment can talk to each other. Well, in order to find each other, they need to have an address. And the layer 2 media access control sublayer provides such addresses. The MAC sublayer also detects or avoids frame collisions, and it figures out where frames start and end. Remember, the physical layer simply provides us with a stream of bits. It's up to the MAC sublayer of the data link layer to figure out where the frames start and end within those bit streams. So to summarize, data link layer is layer 2 in the OSI model, and it can be conceptually broken into the LLC and MAC sublayers. This layer is responsible for transferring data between two devices on the same network segment, and in the process of doing that, it implements framing and collision mitigation abilities. This layer is primarily implemented in software. However, in many cases, the data link layer is actually implemented in firmware that runs inside network devices.